Next up, we have our final talk of this entire workshop series, and that's coming from Sarah Iverson. Dr. Sarah Iverson is a full professor here at Dalhousie University. She's built her career studying the comparative physiological ecology of marine mammals. Oh, yeah, can you get the slides up? Thank you. Developing really pivotal software and techniques like QFASA, which estimates diet composition based on fatty acid signature analysis. And she has also been a part of OTN since its conception. So she and Fred were in the trenches in the beginning working on these grants, and she's the scientific director, has been since its conception. And so I asked her today to talk about OTN and collaborative networks because I really wanted her to talk about kind of the history of OTN, how it was conceived, so that because networks have become so popular, they're popping up all over the place, and we are future telemetry researchers, right? We are all future PIs if we want to be, and so I think we can learn a lot from OTN and what they've accomplished over the last decade, and I'm really excited to hear about the opportunities that we have moving forward. So thank you so much.
Thanks, Kim. It's a pleasure to be here today, but I hope that most of what... most of what I say should be pretty obvious, especially after the week you've spent here. I look around, and all of you are already part of a network, and I see the excitement in the room. I've seen this excitement for over 10 years of people working together, sharing information and experiences, and having fun. And that's a really powerful, potent formula for doing science. And so Rob and Kim asked me to talk just a little bit, and briefly, since I'm the last interruption before lunch and beer, but basically how OTN came about, where does the momentum come from, where did it, and where will it go in the future, what makes a network successful, challenges, and the future, which is really, I think, about your future. OTN actually grew out of an idea from the Census of Marine Life and its decade of understanding diversity in the oceans. And it was launched by really visionary research funding from the government of Canada. And that is that explicitly paired research funding with infrastructure funding. And this has not happened before, and it hasn't happened since, which is really too bad. But it allowed OTN to simply leap to world leadership, and it allowed the Pan-Canadian Science Network to become the real research hub for OTN worldwide. Now, Fred and I have co-led, have co-led OTN since its very inception. Fred was initially delegated or tasked with directing the global infrastructure platform, and I was tasked with directing the Science Network program. And also, I have to be the primary grant holder and still am, unfortunately. But over time, and actually pretty quickly, it basically morphed into Fred and I simply co-leading OTN and leading to what our various expertises is. And it's too bad Fred can't be here right now. So basically that funding was 2008 to 2017. That funding sunsetted in 2017. And at that point, we transitioned and became recognized formally as a major science initiative or one of only 17 national research facilities in Canada. And what's unique about that, there's both good and bads about that transition, is that there's theoretically no sunset date. We are funded on a 5-year cycle that is infinitely, theoretically, renewable as long as we remain relevant to serving the needs of researchers in both Canada and internationally. But the one thing that we get to now think in terms of very long-term kinds of funding, but we are funded only under this MSI for operations and maintenance. We are judged on our research and training, but there is no funding for that under this. There's no paired research money anymore. So that makes it difficult, and we now spend a great deal of time always looking for funding to support our researchers. But in the context of today, I want to emphasize the really critical accomplishments that were enabled by this funding to launch a science network, which is OTN, and where it brought us in the first 10 years. We began as a diverse interdisciplinary group of some 30 to 36 variously renowned or established researchers across Canada who began to build a connected network. I was in charge of trying to get this together starting in 2008, and it was a lot of work. But by 2010, these are simply the different universities that the principal investigators are from. We tried to establish where the linkages were and to try and work towards them as best we can. And by 2014, these had grown exponentially. And a lot of this growth had to do with people like you, our graduate students and postdoctoral fellows, exchange in labs, OTN symposium that brought everybody together. And so by the sunset of 2017 funding, we then had also become much more global in our research network, and we had some like 400 researchers from 20 countries, over 100 species tracked. And in Canada alone, from this research network, we trained over 250 students. So it was really pretty phenomenal. Now, despite the fact that that research funding went away, it hasn't stopped. And demonstrated by this spider web on drugs, in 2019, just last year, this is sort of a map of all the partnerships globally. So the momentum that we started with the launch of OTN hasn't wavered. We've just had to work in different ways. And so I want to talk about the transformation of science by networks. And of course, aquatic animal telemetry standing alone is just fine. We can learn a lot. But it's really integrating it with multidisciplinary approaches where we really take it to the next level. For instance, using multiple types of telemetry instrumentation, combining it with sampling for biochemical, physiological, or genetic kinds of work. Integrating it with new technologies and tools, such as the use of the gliders, which we've talked about, underwater hydrophones and passive acoustic monitoring for baleen whales, the VEMCO mobile transceiver, which uses large animals to track and study the ocean, and animal accelerometers. And not to forget, the critical nature of data and bringing that all together, and basically data analytical tools, data sharing, and which you've heard a lot about and you've worked on and understand the importance. But it should be obvious that one individual and really one lab group cannot do this on their own. And you have to be part of a network to accomplish this kind of thing. And so a really good network can be a powerful platform for sparking new collaborations and developing new tools and techniques, and also for coordinating to make sure we're not duplicating efforts. It can allow, or should allow, much broader engagement with industry and stakeholders, and allows us to coordinate better to affect changes in policy. It can provide a much stronger voice for lobbying for funding. And for the trainees, the students, and postdoctoral fellows, you're not just in a lab of, you know, 2 to 5 lab members. You have 20 to 80 colleagues or more that you're working with, that you're exchanging ideas. You're both getting and providing guidance, and this can be even much larger. And so it's really pretty powerful, and it also allows the ability to bring together a global community and affect real change. And finally, I think all of us would agree, it's really fun. It's really fun to do this work together and see what we can accomplish together. And I think you guys have had fun this week, so I think you'd have to agree. And I'd have to say OTN takes a special pride in our HQP, our former Canadian students and postdoctoral fellows, who have fledged, that is, attained independent research or scientific positions. And just in the last 3 to 4 years, some 15 universities and 9 government positions of our former students. And OTN, as a great network, works really hard to try and get these individuals in those places. And so these early career researchers are our next generation of OTN scientists and our next leaders. So we take great pride in that. But the other thing is that it's not just early career researchers, but a network should work to enable its mid-career researchers. And in fact, OTN has done that since its inception. And we do that by positioning our people for things like nominating them for the prestigious NSERC Stacey Fellowship, which Steve Cook won, the Pew Foundation Fellowship, Aaron Fisk, an NSERC Brockhaus Award, American Fisheries Society awards, things like this that really have, even though these mid-career investigators had established careers, it really launched them. And that was because of the network and what was able to be accomplished. And as you've heard earlier today, OTN communications team has been critical in really getting these stories out and in basically actively promoting these early and mid-career researchers and the things that we do. And because of all this, we've been able to work together to really produce some exciting pieces of work. And maybe the first big one was our invited review in Science of Aquatic Animal Telemetry Around the Globe. And this was really spearheaded by the International Science Advisory Committee and myself, but we basically tasked two of our early career researchers, postdocs, to really take the lead and become the first and second authors, which obviously helped really launch their career. Another great example is Rob Lennox, who led sort of a similar group of people, but a little bit more broadly sampled, to envision the future of aquatic telemetry and what kind of science and training needs to happen. And that was published recently in Bioscience. And then following that, we produced a complete special issue of the Canadian Journal of Fisheries and Aquatic Sciences, which contains some 25 plus papers that showcases OTN and how we have been filling the knowledge gaps and what the first 10 years really brought about. And so this was really powerful. And again, we did that working as a network and helping each other get all these things out. And a final example is that through the network that OTN has grown and our global community, we could put in a concerted voice to add include animal tracking as an essential component of ocean observing over the next decade of ocean science. And so these are very powerful things that networks can do and that OTN has certainly done. And I just want to mention that particularly in the case of ocean science, a few years ago, the Canadian Council of Academies commissioned a review of ocean science in Canada, and they concluded that without a doubt, the questions are simply too big and too complex to be addressed by individuals or individual labs. And it takes academia, technology, federal government, citizen scientists, and communities to really launch world-class networks, and they actually named OTN as one of Canada's world-class networks. So this really has to be the wave of the future, and so we have to continue to embrace it no matter how hard we work, have to work for it. And so the challenges are, as I've said, research funding. It was really easy with a $10 million network. And easy to bring together people. That's gone away. And I have to say that I saved, penny pinched a bunch during that and managed to save some of that funding that got returned to me. And some of that's funding this today because we couldn't fund it under other sources. Networking and communication is essential. Always exchanging new ideas and asking one another what should come next for both research and policy needs, and providing mutual support. Those are sort of no-brainers, but what's really critical is network champions. And you've seen some of them here. I think I needn't go further, that you'll see that it really takes network champions to make that happen, and always thinking about the next leaders. Now, in terms of the future, we work from a strategic plan, which we revise and advance every 5 years. And so over these next 5 years, actually through 2023, we have plans, like we are continuing to commit to advanced technology and infrastructure to increase our coverage. We continue to lead in development of integrated multidisciplinary research proposals and collaboration with indigenous and local communities. We have an emphasis on leading in, as you have seen, data management, analysis, and visualization tools, and bringing these to the worldwide community and to bring them into the OTN network. And finally, diversification of communications, outreach, and knowledge mobilization. So all these we actively devote ourselves to, and we get huge input from not only the OTN personnel, but basically our whole community. And so the future of aquatic telemetry, I think we clearly understand how critical it is if we truly want science-based ecosystem-based management for protecting endangered species, predicting the changes of future animal populations, particularly with changing climates, improving fisheries management and coastal and marine spatial planning. And I can't emphasize enough the communications aspect of it for every single one of us. When I was a graduate student, you were only expected to publish and then move to the next paper. And as a young faculty member, the engagement of public in ocean science through all sorts of means is so critical to our work, to our support, and for really giving back to the community and affecting change. And so for the future of aquatic animal telemetry must be expanded infrastructure, continuing collaborative efforts, sharing of equipment, facilities, expertise, and data, and over ever-increasing scales, but hopefully at relatively minor increments in costs, because it's expensive to do this work, and if we work together, we can reduce those costs. So I'm going to basically finish by simply saying that OTN is a Canadian national research facility. So and a network, but as long as OTN remains relevant to the Canadian and international community, we are theoretically evergreen. And so it's critical that people stay engaged and enthusiastic, as you all have here. And I just want to say how incredibly proud I am of the amazing OTN team that you guys have worked with and interacted with here. And also proud of our OTN's HQPs, early career researchers, and what you've all accomplished together. And that it's just really exciting and invigorating to see. And I think staying engaged and enthusiastic is up to you guys, and it's the mantra that we all have at OTN, and remaining committed to changing the world. And finally, I think to remember that OTN is always looking for the next and new leaders at whatever levels of OTN. And so the emerging leaders that we see now, like you guys, are going to be incredibly important to OTN's future. So I think everyone that is part of OTN should constantly be thinking of that those kinds of opportunities will be coming down for people to take ever more and more leading roles. And with that, I'm going to not hold you too long from your lunch and beer, but if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Okay, well,
Yeah, okay. So the question is that particularly for people on the cusp and early career researchers, there's all sorts of, research and infrastructure needs and how to go about getting help with that. In that first international joint venture program, we had more ready leeway. But we are always seeking out new funding sources. And so the point is to come to us. Also, if you ever see opportunities to that come forward that look like a really cool a grant, we are here to even help you prepare that grant. If you need equipment, we still have equipment that we can loan. It's limited, but we always work to try to maximize the use of that equipment. So if equipment placed in one area or with one group of investigators is now sort of not needed, we can move that readily. And so my only recommendation is come to us for help. And we have the two directors, but I think you saw I think John showed the org chart, but we have a field operations team, we've got the data team, we have the special projects team, and we've got the comms team. And all of them are there to basically help you and try to answer questions.
So pretty much email anybody on the contacts page?
Except me. Yeah, I think Amy and Evelyn are yeah.
Thank you for the presentations. My name is Rafi. Studying in the U.S. Just kind of curious about the networks that have been built. I see that it's more concentrated on the American parts mostly and Europe, but I haven't seen much, especially from Kevin's presentation from John, the networks that is built around Asia.
Well, so I'll try and remember the various parts of your questions. Yes, Asia is a bit of a hole. There are other holes, obviously, and some of them have to do with the socioeconomic and political components of the environment. We're always trying to push towards that. South America was completely underrepresented. We've now started to really bring people in. And exactly like what you're talking about, and here your contact is John, who's sitting across the table from you. There are formal data sharing agreements in joining OTN, and you basically join a family that's there to really help you. And I think you saw that by John's presentation yesterday. And that's you know, you being a leader in that area of the world and joining OTN is the first step, I think, to then possibly then thinking about whether you could even establish a node there. And then you would have your own identity but could be a member of OTN. And in fact, that's what we tried to do with Brazil and have done so. So Yeah, it's not easy, but you have to start somewhere. And so given that we're only 10 years young, I think we've grown a lot. And yes, the other networks, you know, U.S. got themselves organized. I think there was a lot of support. And so we're trying to reach out and provide support to countries and regions that don't have that support from their government. Absolutely. The whole idea is these are partnered, and in fact, some of them, John could easily explain this better than me, but some of them are formal OTN nodes, but they are their own entity, and you know, you're a member of both. So you could be a member of all of them, you know, and you'd still be part of the family. What OTN does is try to bring everybody together so that there is a more, you know, globally united effort. But John can also explain a lot more about that.